Many guitarists praise the music and the style of Jimi Hendrix. What is your opinion about
that? It's funny because at the time Jimi Hendrix was most popular, I was in the process of being the world's biggest jazz snob. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to hear anything about rock and roll or Jimi Hendrix or anybody else. All I wanted to listen to was John Coltrane, Sonny Rollins, Miles Davis, Bud Powell, Art Tatum. I mean, I was a complete, total jazz snob during that time. And I did listen to, a little bit to Hendrix and, you know, a little bit to some Beatles and some other things mm-hmm. that were happening. But I didn't really participate in it. It really wasn't until later, after Hendrix was dead, that I started to really appreciate him. And also, I started to see that he was very closely connected to, like, free jazz in a way. Mm-hmm. I mean, in a way, he's much closer to Albert Ayler or mm-hmm. some kind of free jazz saxophone player than he is to, you know, B.B. King or yeah. something like that. I mean, he was really pushing the envelope and going in a lot of the same direction sound-wise that a lot of the free jazz guys were going at the time.
For me, it's impossible to avoid one question. It is your opinion and your experience with Pedro Knapp.
Oh, Pedro's an unbelievable musician. Certainly, again, like, you know, most of the guys that have been in my band at one time or another, you know, just one of the great young musicians on earth. And, you know, his particular contribution to the band during the time he was in it was so significant because it was really the first time that we really expanded what the group sound could be. And we couldn't have done it without him, actually. He brought to the table, you know, a bunch of new sonic opportunities for us to write for. And, you know, especially that record, First Circle, remains to this day one of my favorite of my own records. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's the record where I felt like we really utilized Pedro, you know, for what he could do. Mm-hmm. And, or not so much what he could do, because I always felt like, you know, we only used about a quarter of what Pedro could do, because there was really only about a quarter of what he could do that intersected with what we wanted mm-hmm. and what we needed. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think that that ultimately was a source of frustration for Pedro, which I 100% understood. Mm-hmm. It's just that the other things that he could do, I really wasn't and sort of am still not that interested in. Cool. It's kind of outside of my zone. Mm-hmm. And, you know, at the point that we met, though, it was something really cool. And I think for him and for all of us, you know, he's just truly a phenomenon as a musician. I can't think of anybody who's got those kinds of skills and such a vast supply of them.
But if he's watching us, you know, he will be flattered with what just mentioned. But you give opportunities to people. You are producing now, if I'm not wrong, a new singer from Israel, Noah, for example. Yeah. You are interested, beside working so hard, in discovering new talents all around the world?
To a certain degree, it's not a gigantic priority with me, only because I don't have that much time. Mm-hmm. And also, the people that I'm interested in are not necessarily the most talented people that I know. It's just that, unfortunately, the world that we live in now is so stratified. You know, there's like, okay, jazz, and then there's, within jazz, there's supposed to be straight ahead, and there's bebop, and this and that. I mean, the world is getting so much like that, that whenever I see somebody who's really talented that doesn't quite fit in anywhere, my heart goes out to them, and if I can help them, then I will. This girl that you're talking about, Noah, was a perfect example of that. I mean, stylistically, it's not even really my zone at all. I mean, I like her. I think she's very good, but I felt like her thing was very unique. It's like I had never really heard anybody that really approach music quite like that, and I felt like she deserved a chance to at least make one record that really documented what that thing is before it sort of got transformed by the powers of the culture into being a little bit more like this or a little bit more like that. And I think we made a really nice record that is sort of filtered through my consciousness or my opinion of what I think of her, but is ultimately a record that I think is very satisfying musically. She's a talent also, somewhat like Pedro, in the sense that she can do a million different things. And she will and she should, but I felt like it'd be good to do one record that was really this very simple, kind of clear version of this kind of offbeat thing that I thought she was good at.
But we'll hear your latest record with the group, and what could we expect from your following record that will be, if I'm not wrong, with the Parmentier group, not a solo effort?
Well, actually, it's, you know, I've just finished making 6 new albums in the last, before I came on this tour. I've been unbelievably busy in the studio. They're not my records, all of them. They're records with other people, but I was very involved in all of them. I'll just quickly run them down. I did Tony Williamson record, who's a great drummer. He's played Miles. It's a quintet album with Herbie Hancock, Michael Brecker, Stanley Clark, and myself. Then I did Then I did a quartet album led by a fantastic young musician named Kenny Garrett, who was the last saxophone player playing Miles' band. It's an album that's dedicated to John Coltrane. We only play the music of John Coltrane, and it's really a nice record, I think. Then I did a quintet album led by one of my very good friends, Michael Brecker. It's the first time he's made his own album in about 5 years. Also a quintet album, this time with McCoy Tyner, Jack DeJohnette, and Dave Holland. It's a really nice record. Then I did a duet album with my very good friend, Charlie Hayden. And this is a record that we've been talking about doing for a long, long time. It's almost all just acoustic guitar and bass duets, and I think it's a really beautiful record, and it's a record that I think people have been wanting me to make for a long time. It's really focusing more on the acoustic thing and more ballads and that sort of thing. But I'm really excited about that record. I did a soundtrack album that goes with this film, Passaggio per il Paradiso in Italian is the name of it. And that album will come out whenever the film comes out here in Argentina, I suppose. And then I've been involved with another very good friend of mine's family for the last few years working on a special project. His name is Jaco Pistorius, great bass player. And he was my best friend for number of years. Since the time he died, there have been a lot of weird things that have happened. There's been a horrible book that came out that was supposed to be a biography that's just a complete tragedy. It's a horrible representation of who he was and what his life was. There have been a number of really bad records, bootlegs, cassettes, people put out towards his later years that are really a drag. The kids, his kids, have formed their own record company. They're putting together what's going to be their first release, which I'm helping them produce, which is a very clear and interesting sort of musical portrait of Jaco in his very early formative years, including a tape of him playing the bass after he'd been playing for about 2 weeks. And basically it covers that time up until the time he joined Weather Report. And it's going to be a CD that'll have a pretty comprehensive book with it that'll hopefully go against some of the factual errors that are in a lot of these other places, and just try to kind of bring his name back up. I mean, people have really bought into this mythology of Jaco as the Charlie Parker of the 90s, and you know, most people don't even really know how he died and stuff like that. So it's something that I'm involved with as a project too. Besides all that, right after I did all that stuff, came here to South America to do the tour, and as soon as we get back, we're going to do a new group record. So really busy.
Yeah, I know. The last thing, which could be the advices that you could give to the young people that probably is watching us, say, well, I would love to play guitar, and what do I have to do in order to make it? Yeah. Here is a person that make it really big.
Well, first of all, making it to me is really like a minor part of the whole deal. I mean, you know, I think if you decide you want to be a musician, the first thing you should realize is the chances of you making it are very, very, very small. On the other hand, anybody that wants to be a musician, I really recommend it, because the more you know about music, it's this unbelievable instructor. It teaches you about not only music, but life and just what it is to be here on earth. There's almost no better teacher in the world than music. I mean, the more you know about music, when you look at a tree, you see it different, you know, and it's just this amazingly open-ended, intellectual, spiritual journey that's fantastic. But the specific thing I would say, in terms of advice, is to try and be the worst guy in every band that you're in. If you're the best guy in the band that you're in, then you should be in another band. That's my main advice. That's how you learn, is to be around musicians who are better than you.
Pat, thanks a lot.
My pleasure.
Thank you. Pat Metheny, con nosotros, aquí en este concierto de lujo hoy, compartiendo una entrevista, creo, bastante profunda con uno de los grandes nombres, los grandes talentos, y bueno, grande como es la humildad que desparramó a lo largo de esta entrevista aquí con nosotros en nuestros estudios. Ahora sí, Pat Metheny en concierto.